Hello, BookTube. It's Terry from Terry Talks Books. And I want to welcome my new subscribers. I had a little uptick in subscribers recently, and that is thanks to Rainy at Rainy Day Reads. She mentioned me in a BookTuber shout-out tag that she did recently, and some of you have apparently come over and followed. So I should be talking to you all at some point. I'm watching your videos too. So anyway, thank you very much. And for everybody else who's been here and continues to listen to me ramble on about books, thank you to you too. I really do appreciate having you all here to talk to about our reading and sometimes other things. So what am I going to do today? Because I am so behind on recording videos, and I've got the same excuse as everybody else. You know, life has just been kind of turned upside down. So making adjustments, still making adjustments. What can I say? You all know, you all get it. So what I'm going to do, what I decided to do, I am not going to try and, you know, cover everything I've read, and I'm probably not even going to do that great of a job covering what I'm going to cover. But I thought what I would do is address my author spotlight books, because that is special to me, and I do want to have a record of that. And because I waited so long, I have two Louise Erdrich books and one Barbara Kingsolver book, and those have been read just long enough ago now that it's already starting to, fade's not really the right word, but you know, I've moved on, I've read other things, and all the little details and thoughts I had are just not quite as clear. So I know you all understand. So I will do my best. And what I'm going to do is cover these three books. I would normally dedicate a video to each one of them, but I think I'll just kind of give them a few brief thoughts and a hat tip and then move along and hopefully do better. I don't know, these days I'm trying to go easy on myself. You know, if I don't do what I think I'm gonna get done, I just have to let that go. So I'm going to be talking about the two Louise Erdrich books would be The Beet Queen and Tracks. Now, I am reading these in the publication order. You can read them in publication order, or you can read what's called the Love Medicine Sequence, which are six of Louise Erdrich's novels. I think it's six. You can read those in chronological order, as in the chronology of the characters, you know, the time sequence of the various stories and plots and characters. So I am doing it in publication order, which puts them all out of whack. Love Medicine was the first published, and it took place in the early 80s, I think. 1981 seems to stick out in my head for some reason. And then Beet Queen, which is, let's see, I'll show you my copy, because everybody has different copies of these things. I have this one. This is one I've had it a long time. So very often when you see many of my books, if they were published a long time ago, I probably have a copy from a long time ago that just didn't get read, or I read part of it. Yeah, you've heard me talk about that before. So The Beet Queen, that's it there. And it's kind of a fun cover. It wraps around. In some of the newer editions, you get kind of a piece of this picture, I think. Not the whole thing. So anyway, so that's my copy. And I think I bought this very shortly after it was published. And it was published in 1986. So anyway, there is that. And The Beet Queen, the contents, the storyline in here takes place between 1932 and 1972. So it really does, it really does cover a huge span of time. And I think, I'm not positive, not yet, but I think that this would just precede Love Medicine in the storytelling sequence. So she wrote Love Medicine first, and then wrote The Beet Queen, so kind of going backwards. And then after that, I read Tracks. There's my copy of Tracks. Yes, I've had this one a long time. Oh, penguins with notes on it. And so there's my copy. This one takes place from 1912 to 1924. So this one goes way back. So I'm going to, you know, I got some answers about some of the storylines and characters going way back. So that was, it makes it in some ways, well, it's kind of hard to keep things straight in all of these books, partly because the time period covered is so large, you know, the better part of a century. And there are many characters with many tangled relationships. So it gets a bit confusing. So I will reread the Love Medicine sequence in the future. I will reread them, and I will read them that the next time I think I'm going to read them in the chronological order and see if that helps some. I might stay confused. I don't know, just because there's just, it covers so much and so many characters. So this so far might be my favorite one. It's hard to have a favorite. It really is hard to have a favorite with these, but you know, there was a lot to like in this one too. This one was a little bit more straightforward in its storytelling, and the characters in these books, the Love Medicine sequence, they cross over, you know, so that you'll see some of the characters, you know, in one book, and then, you know, you'll go back or forwards in time, and you'll have some of the same characters, get further details on their lives. They'll be either younger or older, you know, depending on which direction we're going. So, you know, you keep running into the same names and the same characters again and again. And this one here takes place off the res, so in a town, a small town that's not on the reservation, and it is you see some of the interaction between the indigenous and non-indigenous people. So you know, we have a lot of Scandinavians because of the location. It's in the, you know, central north part of the United States. So there's a lot of Scandinavian people who'd moved there at one point. So so some of our characters, you know, marry outside, you know, of the res. And so we see a little bit of those relationships, but it's primarily off the res in this small town with many of the characters are not indigenous. So I guess that caught me a little bit by surprise. I just didn't quite expect that, I guess. I don't know why. Why not? And then Tracks, this one here. This one we go back to the res. And again, we just have this intertwining of lives between, you know, all of our characters and the various families, and then off the res with the non-indigenous people. So a lot of, it's like Louise Erdrich does a lot of weaving, you know, she really does. That's probably the best way to describe that. And in all of her books so far, the writing, it just continues to be beautiful. And like I said, it's like she's just weaving things. And one of the things she does with that weaving is to pull the physical and spiritual slash supernatural aspects together. And again, I'm overusing the word, but, you know, just weaving them, really weaving them. I do want to say one of my favorite characters is Fleur. And I think one of the reasons I like her so much, she's quite mysterious, but she really is very otherworldly, but she also seems quite grounded in many ways. She would perhaps be seen as a medicine woman or a wise woman. And she seems to just come and she seems to walk between both worlds, both the physical and the spiritual and supernatural. You know, there's, like I said, it's quite mysterious. Is she a shapeshifter? Is she, you know, what is she? But she's definitely in contact, and she with both the physical and the non-physical, the spiritual. And she seems very comfortable with this. It also sets her apart, very much sets her apart from the other characters. And, you know, they set her apart in many ways. Some are fearful of her. Some are intrigued by her. So she's just one of my very favorite characters so far. And I think she has been in each book in one way or another. So I am going to stop there because I don't trust myself to get into a lot of the details. It's rather difficult to do anyway. They're not those kinds of books. But I think, you know, that leaves you with something, you know, I'm still enjoying them. I'm kind of giving them all a 4 out of 5 stars so far. You know, I don't really have a hierarchy of preference, really, at this point. I guess I have a little preference for some characters or storylines over others, but overall, I just like the whole thing, and I look forward to more. I am I just finished this one here. This is the fourth one in this project, which is The Bingo Palace. I just finished this. And I'm still kind of sitting on my thoughts, and hopefully I'll get a dedicated video to this one. There's, like her others, there's a lot there. And just a reminder, I am doing this as a buddy read project all year with Britta Bowler. So you might hear her talk about these books as well. I'm sure you've already noticed that she's been reading them also. So I'm going to move on from Louise Erdrich to Barbara Kingsolver. She is another one of my author spotlights for the year, and so far I've just read one of her books, and it's her first one, The Bean Trees. This one here, and yes, I've had this one for a long time too. This one is, I really want to read more of this, of Barbara Kingsolver's books this year, because, you know, this was a good reminder that I really, really like this, and I want to kind of be in her worlds with her characters. So this one here, The Bean Trees, what do I have to say about that? This is her first novel, and it really kind of focuses on a young woman named Taylor Greer, and she's from Kentucky, and she, for, you know, reasons, gets in her Volkswagen Beetle and drives to Tucson. And I can't remember the time frame for this. Does it say? But the book was published in 1988. So, you know, it goes back. And I'm thinking early to mid 80s would be the setting. And I am very familiar with the Southwest, the state of Arizona, and I am somewhat familiar with Tucson and the surrounding area there. So I felt very much at home while I was reading this book. I just have really, really good feelings. You know, it felt like home while I was reading this. And I was talking, I buddy read this with my sister-in-law. She is also very familiar with this area of the country and with Tucson. And she had read this book a long, long time ago, many years ago. And she didn't remember too much about the book, but she remembers that it made her feel really good too. So she was probably getting the same thing I was, you know, I just felt like home. And I really did enjoy being there. And I like the way Kingsolver described the landscape and the people. And I really like the themes. It's probably enough for me to just give you some of the bigger themes here. And that might tell you whether you want to read this or not. And I actually encourage you to read this, actually. There's a lot there about women's relationships. In fact, there's very few men, and the men that show up are kind of just peripheral, and they're not all bad, but they're just some of them are, I don't know if bad's the word, but just useless for these women. And but even the ones that are have a more positive, you think of them more positively. I'm just thinking of one right now. They're still peripheral. They're not really super central to the story. Another thing that's happening in this book is in the 80s especially, and I can't remember if it bleeds into the 90s or not. It probably does. But this sanctuary for Central American refugees. And there was a lot of that in probably all the southwestern states, but I know about it from Arizona. And these people stayed very hidden, and they were running for their lives. They really, truly were running for their lives. Many of them needed political asylum, religious protection. Just if they went back, they would be killed. So I do remember that about it. So it was just from living there and living through those times. It's a little different, seems to be somewhat different than what I'm seeing now as far as the movement of people and immigration and all of that. It seems there is a difference. I'm just going to leave that there for right now because that's a whole nother thing. But so Sanctuary for Central American Refugees, and just think in terms of the 1980s. Then this idea of what is family. Taylor, on her trip from Kentucky to Arizona, she ends up, I'll just say, acquiring a little three-year-old Cherokee girl. In fact, she's so tiny, and her growth and development has been somewhat stunted because of her living situation. And she ends up with this child. She doesn't kidnap her, but she, you know, this child is put into her arms. It's kind of another sanctuary type of a situation. And so she ends up with this little Cherokee girl. And so, you know, this whole idea, and then all the women helping each other out, the older women, the refugee women, the, you know, the women who are of the same age with children, just helping each other out. And so it does bring up this idea of what is family? And then Taylor, you know, mothering this little Cherokee girl. So they pretty much, they define what family is, and they think of each other as family. And I really like that. It was part of the atmosphere that really drew me in. So she talks about, you know, of course, the human condition in just many aspects because of what we have with the refugees, what we have with the little Cherokee girl, what we have with the, what do you call them, middle American white people. so just the human condition and all the similarities amidst the differences, and that there's struggles, many different types of struggles. This idea of love and friendship, and it kind of is a takeoff on family and defining family. And then the idea of abandonment and belonging. And of course, that ties into the whole family thing as well. So those are some of the really big themes. It was so, I read this so fast. I didn't mean to. I didn't want to read it fast. and it didn't hurt anything to read it fast, but I didn't really want it to end. You know, I really enjoyed being there. And so it was, but I couldn't help myself. You know, it's just, it's her, Kingsolver's story and the way she told it, it just flowed. And for me, you know, often I could feel it, I could smell it because it's the desert. I know what it feels like, that dry air. I know what the smell of sun on hot tires that are being used to section off a gravel parking lot. I know that smell. And just the way all of it looks. And so it had an added element for me. And you can tell that I really liked that. You know, that was, like I said, it was home for me. So I'm looking forward to reading some more of Kingsolver. I'm assuming she doesn't always necessarily stay in the same area of the country and, you know, telling the same types of story, but I really did like her writing. Now this is very, you know, this is her first book. So we'll see where we go. And I need to go dig another one of her books out and read that. So anyway, that's enough of my rambling on, but I thought I wanted to come in and, you know, say thank you, touch bases, say I hope that you're all well, and just, you know, show my face. I'm good. I'm fine. Going nuts like the rest of you. And I'm a total introvert, and, you know, I'm ready to do something. And if anything, just go hiking by myself in a national park. So yes, I'm an introvert, but even for introverts, this can be difficult. So I just wanted to say hello and hope you're well and give you something about what I've been reading. And I will talk to you all hopefully soon, sooner rather than later. So I wish you all well, BookTube. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.